Can I remind everyone to switch off mobile phones and Blackberries or electronic equipment because it might interfere with our recording system. Our first item of business this morning is on a decision to be taken in private, looking to the committee to get agreement to take agenda item 3 on witness expenses in private. Do members agree?
Agreed.
That takes us to agenda item 2, which is consideration of new petitions. The first of those is PE1591 by Catriona MacDonald on behalf of SOS-NHS on major redesign of healthcare services in Skye, Lochalsh and South West Ross. Members have a note from the clerk, the petition and the spice briefing and submissions from the petitioners, and also welcome Mary Scanlon, MSP, to our meeting this morning, who has a constituency interest in this petition. I welcome the petitioners from SOS-NHS to the meeting. That's Catriona MacDonald, Malcolm Henry and Alan MacRae. I invite Mr. Henry to speak to the petition. You have 5 minutes or so and then we'll discuss the issues that you raise with us. Over to you, Mr. Henry.
Thank you very much. We're here because NHS Highland is proposing to close both hospitals on Skye and replace them with a single central hospital. This is a major service change that's been approved by the Cabinet Secretary, and we're here today to ask for your help in getting that approval reversed. I think you've all been issued with a map, is that correct? They're there to help illustrate our argument. If you look at the first map, you'll see that the area is divided into three by the dotted lines. There's North Skye and Rasay, South Skye and Lochalsh, and South West Ross. And the majority of the population in Skye and Lochalsh lives north and west of that line. That's more than 7,600 residents. If you add students and workers and visitors, that can easily double the daily population to more than 15,000. So these are significant figures in the West Highlands and Islands. They might not sound very big to people from the Central Belt, but Fort William only has around 10,000 residents and Oban has fewer than 9,000. So 7,600 permanent and 15,000 through the day is a lot of people. Portree is by far the largest settlement in the area. Broadford's about half the size and then everywhere else is smaller again. The squiggly line between Portree and Broadford shows the line of the road. And the geography of the island means that very few people live along that road. So you've got two very distinct areas, north and south. There are currently two community hospitals, one in Portree and one in Broadford, and they serve the whole of Skye and Lochalsh. The geography of the mainland means that the communities in southwest Ross tend to use Dingwall and Inverness hospitals. Typically, only 1% of admissions to Skye hospitals come from southwest Ross. NHS Highland is proposing to close both of the existing hospitals and build a new one in Broadford. Portree will be left with nothing but a day clinic. The second map on the sheet shows the area overlaid onto the central belt to give you a better idea of the distances that are involved in getting to and from the proposed new hospital. Portree to Broadford takes the same time as driving from Falkirk to Uddingston. And for people in the far north and west of Skye, the journey to Broadford is like driving from Kirkcaldy to Uddingston. So these are significant distances. The coloured circles on the map, on the first map, show that almost everyone in North Skye lives more than 30 minutes by car away from Broadford, and about a quarter of these are more than an hour away. Now, these travel times assume immediate access to a car in favourable weather conditions with no tourist traffic. That's the best time you can make. Public transport between North Skye and Broadford is almost non-existent. So centralising hospital services in Broadford means that the majority of the population will find it much, much harder to use them. Getting to and from hospital for admissions, discharges and visiting will be much more difficult. And the certainty of getting medical attention out of hours by turning up at Portree Hospital will disappear, leaving people to choose between the lottery of the ambulance service, which has response times of up to 70 minutes, or driving the extra 30 minutes or more to Broadford. And again, assuming you have access to a car, which isn't the case for a lot of people. Every part of North Skye features on the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, accounting for about 10% of the population. Two data zones have deprivation rates of 15% or more. Many of these people are elderly or they've got chronic health conditions that prevent them from earning, and this means that few of them have cars. Bus services are sparse or non-existent. Taxi services are just outrageously expensive for the distances involved. So people rely on the goodwill of friends and neighbours to get to and from Portree for hospital admissions, discharges and visiting their sick relatives. Comparatively few people in North Skye routinely make the journey to Broadford. So there are far fewer opportunities of getting a lift to and from Broadford Hospital. This means that the closure of Portree Hospital will exacerbate the effects of the inverse care law, those with greatest health needs having worst access to health services. One of the seven project investment objectives of NHS Highlands redesign is to improve access to services and care. What's being proposed will do the exact opposite for more than half of the population of Skye and Lochalsh. This disjunction between what the redesign is supposed to deliver and what's actually going to happen is alarming, but it's just one example of NHS Highlands' astonishing lack of rigour in the management of this project. You'd expect that a decision on a major service change would be underpinned by hard evidence. You would expect to see numbers showing the current services, how they're used, and the current gaps in provision. You'd expect to see forecasts showing how the proposed changes will contribute to meeting the objectives of the project. In this case, there's nothing, there's no hard evidence of any sort, no before or after numbers to support what's being proposed, no comparative metrics whatsoever. Indeed, the only evidence of data gathering that we can find is an informal request made at very short notice to NHS statisticians in November of 2013. An email from one of the number crunchers is very disturbing. She says that the timescale for information gathering, and I quote, is incredibly tight and leaves no time for thorough checking or validation and interpretation of the analysis. There will also be gaps in the information, and I have concerns about decisions being made on the basis of quite limited information. This seems a high profile and important piece of work, but with an oddly short timescale for information gathering. One of our colleagues echoes her concerns in two subsequent emails, and after that, the bulk of that data request was abandoned. The only data that were used in the local options appraisal and the public consultation document were some raw numbers about populations and drive times, which have been presented in map form that's really quite misleading. The report that was approved by the Cabinet Secretary a year later had references to some more raw numbers, things like current patient activity, bed occupancy and income deprivation, but this is all dumb data. There's no projections, no before or after analysis, no numerical evidence of the potential consequences of the proposals. So this major service change has been decided without any measurable assessment of how it will affect clinical outcomes or access to services or the health of our communities. Despite this glaring lack of evidence in support of the proposals that are being spun by NHS Highlands as being wholly positive, misrepresentation is endemic in everything that is coming out from them. Words like modernisation and upgrade and improvement, they're used again and again, despite the obvious downgrading of access to services for the majority of the population. The public consultation documents refer throughout to Portree Hospital being the spoke to the new hub in Broadford. Nowhere do they admit that the proposed spoke is not a hospital at all. It's merely a clinic. There's no beds. It's not a hospital. The report that recommends the proposals to the Cabinet Secretary emphasises the results of a survey showing 1,900 people in support. Nowhere do they acknowledge that this is an unscientific, self-selecting sample of opinion that wasn't subjected to any independent audit. The options appraisal information in the report implies that the proposals have statistical validity, when in reality there has been no attempt at systematic gathering and analysis of evidence. And most bizarre of all, NHS Highland has repeatedly refused to admit that Portree Hospital has been providing out-of-hours A&E triage and treatment since 2004 and has repeatedly failed to acknowledge the value of this to the communities of North Skye. So we think the Cabinet Secretary has been misled by NHS Highland into believing that the proposed redesign will improve our health services. In terms of access to services, the evidence presented on the maps clearly shows that this isn't the case for more than half the population. That's the obvious flaw. What else is there that they're getting wrong? You know, we don't know. We need to find out. The Cabinet Secretary has also been misled into believing that the people of North Skye are broadly in favour of these changes. Our petition with more than 4,900 signatures suggests the opposite is true. Now, 4,900, that's equivalent to 65% of the population of North West Skye. That's like 300,000 people in Edinburgh putting their names to a petition. We want to be clear that we're not campaigning for the status quo. We recognise that things have to change. You know, the way that healthcare is delivered has to change, but we've got to get it right. If we don't get it right, then if we allow the current proposals to go ahead, then the communities in North Skye are going to suffer. Health inequality will increase. This campaign is about our health, the future health of our communities, not just our health services. The petition asks for an independent, for the establishment of an independent scrutiny panel. We want it to do what NHS Highland has failed to do. We want it to define our medical, health and social care needs, define the minimum acceptable levels of access to these services, and we want it to recommend how our local services should be delivered. But first of all, we need the Cabinet Secretary to reverse her approval of the major service change. We need her to recognise that there's a lack of evidence in support of NHS Highland's claims that the changes will improve and upgrade services. So far, she's refused to acknowledge that NHS Highland may be guilty of misleading her or that their proposals might be flawed, and we're asking for your help to get her to change her mind. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Henry. I'll come to Mary Scanlon if you want to make some contributions in support of the petition, Mary.
Thank you, Convener. Can I also put on record my thanks to Katrina, Malcolm and Alan, who have travelled a considerable distance to be with us today. Can I say that I first met SOS Skye quite a few months ago. They came along to a surgery that I had in Portree, and I think it was about 15 or 20 people. And it's just to say, Convener, that they came from all walks of life. They were all ages and all walks of life and highly representative of the community. And I think you can see that today by the petition that they've put forward with 4,900 signatures in a community like Skye. It really exemplifies and it tells you the concern and the worry and the uncertainty that people have there. So what we have before us today and with this petition, Convener, is a community that care passionately, not just about the services just now, but what will be there for future generations. And that's the responsibility that they feel. It's for their children and their children's children. Can I just say there was a consultation over a hospital provision on Skye, and these are the two remaining hospitals. Quite a few have been closed over the years since I became an MSP. But there was a previous consultation which only included the Isle of Skye. It was thrown out. And to be fair, it was very badly handled. It was very badly handled indeed. It was thrown out and they started all over again. So instead of looking at Skye, and I know you've all got maps in front of you, tagged on was the west coast of Scotland and Skye and Kyle of Lochalsh and southwest Ross, which meant that where Portree was the centre of Skye, it was no longer the centre of this huge area. When Malcolm talks about a major service change, and I think when we hear, and I was on the health committee long enough, when we hear about a major service change, we presume that it's a great big, you know, 800-bed hospital. It needn't be. This is a major service change for people living on the Isle of Skye. And I think that's my concern about this petition, because when we say major, we assume it has to be a huge hospital and something, but this is major to Skye. And I hope the members of the committee will appreciate that. I know we've got our man from the Western Isles here today, but to this community, this is a huge major service change. I do not think the consultation has been well done. I don't think it's been done. Malcolm mentioned not having enough information and evidence, but I don't think it's been done in a respectful or a dignified way, working in partnership with the community. It's not a lot to ask, and it doesn't cost a lot of money. It's just a bit of common decency and answering the questions that they're asking. That really hasn't happened. I would have liked to see this one sent to an independent scrutiny panel, which quite rightly was promised by Nicola Sturgeon, where there would be a major service change, and I support that. So the thing that I find that also differs here from the central belt of Scotland, if we look at a category A call for the ambulance, in an urban area, we expect that ambulance to be there in 7 minutes. That's not the case on Skye. I mean, Malcolm mentioned 30 minutes. I can tell you times that are longer than that, and we've had a history of single-manned ambulances there as well. That's much better now, but it is a problem. So the lack of rigour, no hard evidence, the timescale's very tight, but the thing that really worries me is this is a community where, you know, they're losing their hospital, and I think that they're all big enough and wise enough and professional enough to know that health services change, but they don't know what's coming in its place. And it's that uncertainty that they're left with. And that's where I think if there'd been a bit more respect, a bit more working together, that would have been better. I thought I would take the opportunity today to highlight one of the, what I personally consider is a very poor service on Skye, and that's mental health services. And I think that that's a problem now. And I think while the petitioners are seeking resolution, looking for certainty, looking for information, I would certainly be looking for what support will be given in mental health services. So really all I wanted to say was sustainable communities for future generations depend not only on having a good local school, but they very much depend on, if I take ill, where's my nearest NHS services? Now, we all want the Isle of Skye to continue to prosper. It's a wonderful, wonderful place to live. But I do commend the petitioners today. They have not been given the information that they need. They've not been given the assurances they need. This is a worried community because they have been kept in the dark. When they ask questions, they're not being responded to in a helpful manner that gives them the information that they need. So I hope, convener, that you will take on board the points that are made today. And just finally to say, 65% of any community signing a petition really highlights the worry and the concern that they have on behalf of others. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Mary. Angus, you want to kick off with questions?
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. You've mentioned in your opening statement that you're calling for an ISP or an independent scrutiny panel. Now, as we know, in some cases, the Scottish Government can choose to establish an ISP. However, it's normally in advance of the final decision. Has anyone from NHS Highland explained to you why an ISP wasn't initiated in the first place?
No is the answer. What they've said to us is that it's not their business and it's up to ministers to call for an ISP. However, in the press, I think it was 3 years ago on the BBC, they stated that the Kate Earnshaw, who works in the operational team up there, stated that they may well have to get independent scrutiny of any proposals because it was indeed a very controversial decision-making process. And it's been ongoing. I know there's been big decisions, controversial decisions in Lanarkshire and Galloway, etc., that had ISPs. The one on Skye goes back 50 years. You know, it is a controversial decision. And the notion of going through it without independent scrutiny from the beginning was pretty irresponsible. And although NHS Highland say, well, it's up to the ministers, they definitely would have a hand in requesting it, I believe, if they thought that it was going to help them bring the public with them through the process. And no, it wasn't. And we've actually asked Gary Coutts directly, and he said, we didn't need one. And it's not up to us to establish one. It's up to the Scottish Minister.
But just for clarification, you said that there's an official on record accepting that there should be a need for an ISP?
It's suggesting that there may well be a need for one. Yeah, I've got that. It's on a BBC website. It's in the archives. I can show you that.
Right, that'll be helpful. Moving on to the transport issues, clearly, you know, there are issues getting from North Skye down to Broadford. Have NHS Highland offered I'm thinking about the situation in the area I represent in Falkirk East, where we had a new hospital built within the last 10 years, and NHS Force Valley provided bus services to feed into the hospital, which was out of the way. It wasn't near any major, or within walking distance of any major settlement. So have NHS Highland offered or indicated that they would be willing to provide bus services from North Skye, from South Skye and Lochalsh, and from South West Ross? Has that been on the table?
No, NHS Highland has stated, I can't remember which document I read it in, that they're not in the business of providing transport. When it was pointed out after this became public of what they're proposing, they agreed to set up a transport steering group, which is ostensibly driven by NHS Highland, but it's chaired by one of our local customer councillors. And we've had representation at, I think, three of the meetings now. And in each case, the lack of rigour that we've seen in the rest of this process is the same thing as happening in the steering group. It's, frankly, it's a joke. There's no attempt being made to assess the current requirement for getting from the outlying areas of North Skye to Portree, never mind what the implications are going to be for moving all these services to Broadford. So, in answer to your question, no, NHS Highland is not going to do that, and nobody has any clue how these things are going to work in the future.
Okay, it just seems strange to me that NHS Forth Valley are in the business of providing transport, whereas NHS Highland are saying that they're not. So,
Highland about
yes,
that.
Yes, indeed, and I'm sure we might well do that.
Again, there are official records of them saying frequently, we are not a transport provider. Mm-hmm. So they've made this decision, which clearly has transport implications, and then offloaded the transport side to others, including Highland Council. And there's huge funding implications for this, but they aren't taking responsibility for that. The transport steering group's been going for a year now, and they haven't even assessed current transport, far less what future requirements might be. It really is a farcical situation.
You would have thought a traffic assessment would have been paramount. Okay, thank you.
Well, thank you, Chairman.
Good morning. Malcolm, you've mentioned on several occasions that the Cabinet Secretary has been misled. In my part of town, we call it lying. Could you give me a couple of examples where that has actually happened as a matter of fact, so that ISP could be considered as a serious option?
We consider that the whole report that the Cabinet Secretary based her decision on has been prepared in order to justify a decision that was made at least 10 years ago to centralise hospital services in Broadford. The public consultation and the subsequent report that was approved by the Board of NHS Highland and the Cabinet Secretary has all been designed in order to make the decision appear rational. And one way that she's been misled is the inclusion of South West Ross into the catchment area for the new hospital in Broadford. As I said in the presentation, typically 1% of admissions to the Skye hospitals come from South West Ross, and all of that 1% goes to Broadford. So zero have been going to Portree. There have been a few referrals to Broadford for outpatient stuff, which in some places like Lochcarron is closer to Broadford than it is to Dingwall. So in those cases, there is some support in South West Ross for the proposals. But if anybody is going to be an inpatient, then they don't want to be in Broadford. They want to be in Dingwall or Inverness for lots of reasons. And if anybody is in need of acute emergency care, there is no way that they're going to go from anywhere in South West Ross to Broadford for that. they will either call an ambulance, which will take them to Rigmore, or they will get in the car and they'll go to Dingwall or Rigmore. That's just the way that the geography works. So that's just one example of how she's been misled, but yeah. Alan's probably got more.
Well, I'd like to point you towards the end of this SPICE briefing. And in the last paragraph, Shona Robertson, it says, it made a decision based on what it thought was the best available evidence. Now, you know, I think that the Scottish Government, you know, approved this in good faith, and I'm not questioning their good faith in this, but I think this, because this is from a Freedom of Information request, I don't think anyone here will have seen this as yet. Malcolm quoted it, you know, to say, due to the tight timescale, there will also be gaps in the information, and I have concerns about decisions being made on the basis of quite limited information. Now, this is from the Public Health Department within NHS Highland. These are the guys who provide the statistics. This is not even somebody external who's got a beef with NHS Highland. This is their own people saying that they don't have confidence in the statistics that they have provided because it was done on such a tight timescale. And this was done for the options appraisal where the very specific decision was made. So, I mean, there's a perfect example. And again, did NHS Highland know about this? Yes, they did. Because I've got email confirmation. So NHS Highland knew that their public health department had said, no, we don't have that, and that, because you're only giving me a few days, but I can get you some of it, but I won't be able to verify it or look at it rigorously. So, yeah, it's in written confirmation and emails, absolutely.
Chair, I wonder if those emails could be shared by our committee staff so that we can actually let the Cabinet Secretary know as part of our findings at the end, because I think it's important that if the Cabinet Secretary has been lied to or misled or whatever polite language one wants to use, it's not on.
Absolutely. We will make everything available. We just didn't want to load you with information prior to this, but anything specific, we'll furnish you with that.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you.
Okay, David.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everybody. Can I take you to a consultation by NHS Highland? And can I just quote you here? It says, overall, the Scottish Health Council was satisfied that NHS Highland had followed the guidance on involving local people in its consultation. Could you expand on why you feel that the consultation was flawed?
I wouldn't mind, but I've said a lot. To be honest, I think that there is a problem with the way the Scottish Health Council oversee these matters, and this is quite fundamental, and we're not trying to take on the Scottish Health Council as well, but the fact of the matter is the Scottish Health Council go through the consultation on a parallel path, so they become part of what's happening at the consultation. Now, there are elements of the Scottish Health Council's report. For example, they say in black and white, we believe that the spread of meetings was equitable. In other words, that it was equally throughout the place, which is simply factually incorrect. Now, again, I think this is from a situation where the Scottish Health Council have said to NHS Ireland, what's the situation? And they said, that's the situation. But it's simply in black and white incorrect. So I'm not saying I don't value the Scottish Health Council's input, but I think there are major flaws. And for example, the actual returns to the consultation, there was 2,500 altogether, which is half the amount of signatures we have, by the way, and we haven't had the resources to put them through every letterbox in the entire area. 2,500 responses, almost 20% of these responses had no address on them. Now, this is statistically bonkers that you take them into account, because you can have somebody sitting in a house ticking boxes, putting them through, and this is on their own records. Secondly, what you find is that there's a 10% greater return from the area in which the new hospital is going to be sited than there is from the north of the island. Now, that's 10%. That's statistically very significant. It's double, essentially, because one was 10 and one was 20%. You know, that's a major difference in how many people were returning the consultation documents. Now, we're not suggesting that we know where any new hospital should go, whether there should be one new one, whatever, but we are suggesting that there are flaws and there is enough reasonable doubt in the process and the information and the clinical consensus that an ISP would be the best way forward.
Can I chip in there as well? There's also, I don't understand how something technical like deciding how health services are going to be delivered in an area like Skye and Lochalsh, in fact anywhere, can be largely informed by a public consultation. You know, we're ignorant of what should be there, of the clinical need, the transport needs, that, you know, we've got ideas, but we don't know. And there's no hard evidence behind this. The consultation process didn't provide any before and after figures, anything that says this is what you've got just now, these are the gaps in provision, this is what we're proposing, and this is how what we're proposing will affect the services. There's none of that. All it is do you think the single hospital should be in Broadford or Portree or somewhere else? And that's it, basically. There's a lot of waffle and there's no evidence. So that's our main objection to the to such weight being given to the consultation.
Sorry, Katrina.
Just a couple of specifics on the consultation. One was that the majority of people, particularly in the north of Skye, believed that the decision had already been made. And indeed, that was reported in the local press, that the decision was made before the questionnaire went out. And the second thing about the questionnaire is that it was biased. If you went through that questionnaire, you got to a point where you were given the choice about the preferred site for the hospital, and there were several sites in the Broadford area. So the design of the questionnaire was such that if it was answered particularly by the majority of people in the Broadford area, which it was, that you would get this overwhelming majority appearing to support Broadford as the preferred site. So
I've got something else I'm afraid to add, because I know that written evidence is really important in this, and this is as part of the Freedom of Information request that exposed the fact that they didn't have enough evidence to even base the decision on. I put in a Freedom of Information request regarding the sort of concurrent proposal that's happening in Badenoch and Strathspey. Now, what should happen is that the operational team put in a formal request to the public health team asking for statistics that will support their decision-making process. Now, one of the things, as you well know, is public consultation shouldn't be second-guessed, and there's a suspicion on Skye that obviously they'd made their decision up to a decade ago on this whole thing, and the statistics have all been moving towards proving this. This is from the Badenoch and Strathspey team. They were trying to make a similar decision on where to site a new hospital. This is prior to the decision being made. Now, this is very key, prior to the decision being made. Either as part or one of these maps or separately, would it be possible to somehow show the population centres as a percentage of the overall BNS population? We are wanting to show that Aviemore is the fairest place to have the new facility. Now, Aviemore may well be the fairest place to have the new facility. I don't know. I'm certainly no expert on that one. But the fact that they've asked for this information to prove a decision that they want is, it's actually scandalous. Sorry.
Thank you. He's entitled to your opinion. John.
Thank you. Good morning. It's just to go back to the report that referred to the Scottish Health Council. And of course, my colleague said that they were overall satisfied with the work that had been done. But also, according to the SPICE report, makes reference to the identify some areas of good practice. But they then use a phrase that, together with some learning points, would you like to give any indication what you think those learning points might have been in relation to the work that was carried out? Because I'm really concerned, Mr. Henry and Mr. MacRae, you have both said that you are under the impression the decision to site the hospital in Broadford was made 10 years ago or a decade ago. And what we're now seeing is the health board trying to get the facts to fit the decision rather than the decision to fit the facts. On you go.
No. You're quite right. I don't. What things were missing from NHS's consultation that the Scottish Health Council found, I don't know the answer to that. But I mean, a lot of information is what I would suggest. A lot of statistics. I don't know what the Scottish Health Council's findings on that were actually. So I'm sorry. I'm not sure what they felt that NHS Ireland could learn from. I mean, clearly, if you ask us, it's an awful lot. But
similarly, I can't comment on, I don't have what the learning points were. I know that was part of the report. But I think, with respect, the Scottish Health Council, Council are there as observers. We were all part of these consultations. You're given a questionnaire to say, did you, was there a presentation of the facts? Did you get a chance to ask questions? Was the meeting conducted well? And it's very easy, if you tick all these boxes, say, yes, I did get a chance to ask questions, it sounds as if the consultation has been carried out in the right way. But when you look at some of the detail, there's a list in the consultation report of a number of the issues that were raised by local people. For example, this concern that Mary expressed so clearly about the reduction in service provision. The kind of answer, and indeed, NHS Ireland wrote down all these issues that we raised, and they have given responses. So again, the Scottish Health Council could say, yes, well, tick, that's been done very well. But when you look at the responses, you get a response, for example, in relation to the issue about our concern about services for older people. With our increasingly aged population, increasingly frail population, services are already extremely stretched locally. When we raise that concern, you then get a response, but we're going to improve community services and care at home. That will lead to a reduction in the need for inpatient beds, and it will mean that people will be in hospital for a shorter period of time. So that's the answer. Now, I don't know if you find that a reassuring answer, but we find that to be, you know, glossing over the truth, basically.
Convener, to the issue about the presentation of the facts. Mm. There's no facts can be presented, but not all the facts need to be on the table. And clearly, what I'm picking up from you this morning is that the situation you feel is that all the facts, no, the questionnaire that was, or the survey that was carried out, only alluded to where the hospital could be sited in one particular area in Broadford, or in areas of Broadford, rather than looking at the whole of the service that's provided in the area and looking at what exactly would be best suit the residents of the whole area, rather than looking at, right, we've made a decision, we want to have one major centre and then we'll have a clinic elsewhere. It's whether or not all the facts were presented, and that part of what we've got to do as a committee is assess whether we feel all the facts were presented to allow people to make a meaningful contribution to any consultation process that was carried out by the health board.
About the consultation is what was happening in Portree was always described as an upgrade on documentation. Now, it's many things, but closing a hospital is not an upgrade of facilities. And yeah.
Yes. In response to what you're saying, and also Mr. Malik, one of the key areas in which everybody has been misled, and the consultation process was very much at fault here, is the closure of Portree Hospital. What that means is that there will be no medical personnel in Portree on duty 24/7, 365 days of the year, which is what it's been for the last 50 years in Portree. And what NHS Highland will tell you is that this isn't a change. they will say that our out-of-hours care is exactly the same as it's been since 2004. Now, we've all used the out-of-hours service in the last 10 years, and we can tell you categorically that this is a change, because there are three routes to out-of-hours care. You can dial NHS 24, which means you typically wait for 2 hours before you get to talk to a nurse, who will then do their best to do some diagnosis blind on the testimony of somebody on the end of the phone who has got no medical expertise. Or you can dial 999, and our ambulance service, the range of response times is 0 minutes to 70 minutes in North Skye. Now, 0 minutes is somebody in Portree with the ambulance that's based in Portree being there. 70 minutes is probably the ambulance on its way back from Inverness. The average is 16 minutes, and we couldn't get an answer for the median, but it must be around about the 35 minutes. Now, if you're having to wait 35 minutes for to get somebody who can diagnose, who can tell you what's wrong with your person who's ill, then that's quite scary. So what we do is, we've got a third route. Up until recently, we have a third route, and that's you drive whoever it is to Portree Hospital any time of day or night, and at the very least, a nurse says, oh, this is serious, gets on the phone directly to the rural practitioner in Broadford, who then deals with it appropriately. So that's the most certain and also the quickest way of getting help. Now, that's been taken away from us. It's already been taken away from us. They've actually disciplined, well, they haven't disciplined anybody, but they have demanded that the nurses in the hospital lock the doors at night, and people are being turned away. Now, I actually worked it out. This removal of this route to care is a 73% reduction in what we've had up to date. By only having this service available in hours between 8 in the morning and 6 at night, that's been reduced by 73%. Now, how anybody can call that a modernisation, an improvement or an upgrade, I really don't know. And if you're looking for examples of misrepresentation, then that's a fundamental one. NHS Highland have sat in meetings with us, and we have been shouted down by the managers of NHS Highland, said, that's not the case, that's not how it works, that's not how it works. We all know exactly how it works because that's how we use it.
Okay, Mary, do you want to make a comment?
Small point, Convener. I wanted to say that I share the concerns about the Scottish Health Council. To be honest, I've been very disappointed at their approach here. I feel that they go through a tick box exercise without any real understanding of what's happening locally. When you were asking the petitioners, or I think it was Katrina that said, you get asked, can you ask a question? Well, yes, they've been asking questions for years. The problem is that they haven't had answers, you know. So I think the Health Council are very good at saying, can you ask a question? Has there been a public display? Yes, but asking questions is great. But if you're not getting the answers to help you understand what health services you're going to have in future, it is difficult. And just finally, Convener, Alan mentioned there was a similar parallel consultation done in Badenoch and Strathspey, because there's a hospital in Granton-on-Spey and St Vincent's in King Ussie. Now, in that case, I would actually say that the consultation was done so much better than it was done on Skye. And to be fair, all credit goes to a local GP, Boyd Peters, who led the consultation. So this was a local health practitioner who went out to the communities, and people had trust in him. They knew what he was saying would happen. Now, it's my understanding, and the petitioners may want to confirm this, but it's my understanding that no GP in the north of Skye was willing to take that lead that was taken in Badenoch and Strathspey, which was unfortunate. So that's why it's been left to the petitioners.
Yeah, I'd like to just say, I think it's a really good point about the involvement of doctors, because I think one of our main points here is there is a lack of clinical consensus on the way forward here. Now, we've got reams of evidence, again, I can give it to you after, that show that the doctors within Skye disagree really quite intensely about the process going forward and where it should be, and I've got it all in writing. But even more than that, there's people from out with the process, and I think this is a very key point, because if you don't have clinical consensus, then it's very difficult to take something forward without some sort of independent scrutiny. I mean, if I can just make a couple of quotes from senior physicians, this is Dr. Cal MacRae, he's Associate Professor of Cardiology at Harvard. I'm sure any physician would fully support efforts to move care to the community, but there are some emergencies that can only be dealt with in an appropriately staffed inpatient unit. Without such a unit, key optimally located, acute care in Skye Lochalsh will be a source of substantial liability and long-term economic disadvantage. And then he goes on to Derek Bell, Professor Derek Bell of the Royal College in Edinburgh, President of the Royal College, says that concerning the outcome of this process going forward, obvious patient safety issues and the lack of conformity to basic clinical standards. That's how he can see considers this process. So that's they're very serious people, and they're having a major issue with the clinical side of this. I mean, Professor Bell is one of the world's foremost experts on acute medicine. You know, he really is a very accomplished man, and he's got a problem with the way that services are being designed in this specific case.
I'm going to pull things to a conclusion, but before doing that, the reference to the clinicians I was going to comment on, because in your opening statement there was very little mention of the support from clinicians for this decision. And Mr. MacRae referenced the decision that was taken in Lanarkshire some time ago. And my mind was already being cast back to that discussion around the service changes in Lanarkshire. And again, based on what you've said this morning about a decision having been made and then trying to get the facts and figures to justify making that decision, that was all very reminiscent of what transpired in Lanarkshire 10 years ago. But there are one or two major differences. In Lanarkshire, there had already been a problem identified by the health board and by clinicians, which was an inability of the health board to retain clinicians. There was an expectation that unless change was brought about, they weren't going to be able to retain the levels of consultants and staff in accident emergency units unless a transformational change was made. Over 80% of staff and clinicians at that time supported that position, and yet it was overturned when the decision that was ratified eventually to try and address that problem, it was overturned. And here we are 10 years on in Lanarkshire, and the predicted problem has transpired, and we've actually got a worse problem than had been predicted. You know, the vacancies in consultants is greater than had been predicted 10 years ago. So although the decision was based on arriving at an identification of a problem and then trying to find the solution to that problem, what appears to be different with yours is that there's no evidence that clinicians have identified this problem and are seeking a solution.
Well, that's not wholly correct. I mean, there has been a desire amongst some of the clinicians in Skye to have a central hospital for quite some time because they believe that it'll be easier to provide care. But at the same time, I haven't heard a single one say that, for example, if the central hospital is in Broadford, they all say there is a need for nursing care beds at the other end of the island. And it would be the same if the decision was to put the central hospital in Portree. And there is also the out-of-hours acute care. All of them, if you got them in a room on their own, would agree that they have concerns about this model of only having NHS 24 or 999 to get acute care out of hours, because the population is used to driving to the hospital because they know that's the way to get help. And so there is some support for the central hospital concept amongst clinicians, but they have concerns about how the services fit around that.
Yeah,
that's as I said, I'm trying to bring us to a conclusion. What I'm trying to do is identify what it is we're asking for here. Obviously, the first thing is to ask the Scottish Government if they're going to halt the decision or look again at the decision. But I think from what you've said, we also need to look at the operational decisions of NHS Highland. How did they arrive at this conclusion? And
exactly how they arrived at this conclusion. They are in serious financial trouble. If you ask Mary Scanlon, she'll tell you all about it. You only need to look at the audit committee proceedings to find that. And they are looking for ways of reducing operating costs. And that's, as far as I can see, that is the main driving force. That's the problem that they've identified and they're trying to solve. They haven't identified a clinical problem or a service provision problem. They've identified a financial problem, and this is one of the ways they're
trying to solve that. Was the point I was making earlier. I mean, in your opening statement, you made a lot of reference to statistics and analysis of figures and what have you. There was very little mention of clinical imperatives in the decision. It seemed to be about number crunching. And I think we have to ask and investigate whether that is what has driven this.
Yes.
That's the point I'm making, and that's why I was referencing Lanarkshire. The driving force behind the proposed change in Lanarkshire was clinician-led. It was staff and clinicians saying that there was a problem that needed to be addressed. And ultimately, the Scottish Government reversed that decision. Now, here we've got one that's based on finance.
There is also the fact that Broadford Hospital is 100 years old, and by all accounts, it's no longer fit for purpose. It's really hard to make it work for modern medicine. So they have to replace Broadford Hospital anyway. You know, that's got to the stage where it needs to be replaced.
Yeah, it's an interesting history of hospitals on Skye. There was five hospitals. All of them were paid for with, you know, benevolent funding, basically. The first time there's ever been a hospital that was paid with public money and optimally located was Portree Hospital, which is in Portree, obviously, and that's 50 years ago because that's the main demographic centre and there was a real gap. The others, I mean, they used to have one in Uig, a maternity hospital right up the north, which obviously wasn't cited for any optimal reasons. It was just put there because so-and-so said, here's some money, build a hospital there. That's the way it used to be done. So I think it's very important here that public money is used optimally. And that's one of the reasons the statistics are very important, because we have to look going forward, where is the best place to offer services? I mean, I don't want to second guess anything, but it's quite unusual the way that they seem to have done it. They've chosen quite a spurious geographical area, and then they've sort of gone, right, well, there's a geographic bit that's quite central.
Investigate why they arrived at that decision.
Precisely, we do, and it goes back at least a decade.
There are two aspects to this, and that's the point I'm trying to make, and trying to get to see if we can get agreement amongst colleagues. We have to ask the Cabinet Secretary if she's prepared to review the decision. But secondly, we need to ask questions about the decision-making process within NHS Highlands. The members agree that. And we can ask questions based on that. Hansala?
ISP, I think, is on the cards. Clearly, the amount of misrepresentation, I'll try and stay politically correct, that's been coming and going from what the petitioners are clearly claiming. I think an ISP would be a very positive way forward that could address some of the issues that are being brought. Nicola Sturgeon, now the First Minister, if she's made commitments, I'm sure she would want to honour them. And I think she needs to get the right information. An ISP would be a good source for that information, I believe.
David? You wanted to...
I would just like to see a questionnaire. It was sent out. If we could get a copy of that from NHS Ireland.
Yeah, we get a copy of that from
even from the petitioners themselves. Because no doubt you'll have one.
You did offer to send us other information.
Well, that's what I was going to say. If you want to give us, because we've got a lot of written evidence, because I know it's, there's hearsay and there's stuff that we've got in hard writing that you'll want to see, obviously. Yeah. And
if you can provide the class with that, that would be helpful. But yeah. I think we also need to consider writing to the Scottish Health Council just to get their take on what you've said this morning, because clearly there's been issues raised about their... scrutiny of the process. Yeah, I think we need definitely. To ask them about that, Angus.
Yes, I certainly agree, convener, that we should write to both the Scottish Health Council, Scottish Government and NHS Highland, but also while we're writing to NHS Highland, can we specifically ask them why they've not offered to provide transport from North Skye? And, you know, we could perhaps use the example of NHS Forth Valley, where a precedent has been set.
Legitimate question, we'll do that. We'll take the petition forward in that way to start with. We'll wait to see what responses we get. And obviously we'll furnish you with the outcome of the correspondence that we have, and we can communicate with you at that point. And we'll take the petition forward. Until, John, do you want to?
Sorry, just one thing I was wanting to raise is that if we are writing to Scottish Health Council, could we get a definition of what learning points are and what in particular...
We've actually...
But in terms of the findings in relation to the work that was done by Highland Health Board in relation to the consultation, because it would be useful to find out if those learning points related to the way the consultation was carried out, because the Mary Scanlon made reference to the Badenoch-Strathspey consultation exercise, and it would be interesting to find out if some of the learning points actually then were translated into the consultation methods that were being used in Badenoch and Strathspey that weren't being applied in the relationship to the Skye situation, because clearly if there are learning points there, then if it related to the way consultation was being carried out, then clearly the consultation process may have been deemed to have been flawed.
We do have access to the learning points. We have them here. But what we can do, John, is ask in comparison to the other consultation whether those learning points were put in place. So we can establish that. But I don't think we have to establish what the learning points were. We already know them.
Right. Okay.
So, as I said, we'll be in touch with you, obviously, when we get the responses. But thanks very much for travelling so far this morning to speak to us.
Yes, thank you. Much appreciated.
I'll suspend for a couple of minutes till we change witnesses.
morning is PE1583 by Lisa Willis on primary school playground supervision. Members have a note by the clerk, the petition itself, the space briefing and a submission from the petitioner. So I welcome the petitioner, Lisa Willis, to the meeting. She's accompanied today by Wendy Palmer, who's also been involved with the petitioner in her campaign. So I invite Ms. Willis to make some introductory comments and then we'll discuss the issue that you raised with us.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for inviting us to attend the meeting today. The campaign Keeping Our Children Safe in Scotland at Primary Schools in Scotland was born out of concern for the safety of my son, then aged 5, who was arriving on school transport to a playground with no adult supervision. After addressing concerns with the head teacher of the school and latterly with Aberdeenshire Council, I began to explore the views of other parents and uncovered an issue of nationwide concern, evolving into the petition in front of you all today. The Scottish Government acknowledges through guidance and endorsement a duty on the part of local authorities to take reasonable care for the pupils in their charge, which extends to pupils travelling on school transport. This duty of care is echoed in various legislation and guidance. However, the word reasonable leaves fulfilment of this duty open to considerable variation in practice. The law expects school staff to take reasonable measures to ensure that children under their control are not exposed to unacceptable risks, at least those which can be foreseen. And the head teacher must see that procedures are in place to identify such risks and control them, as evidenced by North Ayrshire Council, who, having conducted a thorough risk analysis, require all primary school playgrounds to be supervised for 15 minutes before school starts. Similarly, teachers have a duty of care since 1893 in loco parentis. This means that the teacher stands in place of the parent and is expected to exercise the same standard of care as a reasonably careful parent would. In 1893, the teacher's working environment was not very different from the domestic environment, and a teacher would work with a small number of children. Now, however, things are very different, and teachers are responsible for a large number of children. However, while existing legislation stipulates that most primary schools must have playground supervision at break and lunchtime, there is no mention of the period before school, where children can arrive up to 20 minutes early, many on dedicated school transport. Data collated from Freedom of Information requests highlights that, in fact, only 17% of the 29 councils we've contacted have a formal policy in place for supervising pupils in the playground at this time of day, whilst 43% have a form of recognised practice in place in some but not all of their schools. Others argue that they are adequately fulfilling their duty of care towards safety of pupils by having a member of staff on premises inside the building for these 20 minutes, while some have stated that the responsibility for children lies in fact with parents until the school bell rings. For parents who utilise school transport, this lack of legislation highlights a definite gap in the government's recognition of risk and duty at this particular time of day. Comments received from signatories and through our Facebook page demonstrate many parents and carers are not satisfied with the current situation at this time of day, and they have shared with us their concerns, quoting a catalogue of incidents, the majority with regards to bullying and stranger danger. Similarly, incidents recorded by councils, as evidenced prior to the meeting, include fractures, road traffic accidents, bites, other forms of bullying and aggression, as well as children actually wandering off premises. Only 55% of councils responded to that particular request. Because of the lack of supervision, many parents who don't utilise transport wait with their children or arrive at the school bell, exacerbating congestion and missing out on valuable playtime. Discussion has in fact further revealed that supervision is often assumed by these parents who are choosing to remain with their children and also by older P7 pupils. We believe this is neither adequate nor consistent form of support. Supervision will of course not prevent all incidents. However, the benefits of supervision go further than safety alone. Recommendation 12 of Better Behaviour, Better Learning, the report of the Discipline Task Group 2006, encourages authorities and schools to consider promotion of positive behaviour outside the classroom on the basis that it can contribute to better concentration and behaviour in class. Research also suggests that the provision of supervision within the playground in the period before school starts can result in less traffic congestion and an increase in school transport utilisation, which marries well with the aims of the Scottish Government's Road Safety Framework to 2020, which aims to reduce the utilisation of cars from home to school and promote more active travel. Evidence further suggests that reducing parent congestion at this time of day will allow children more opportunity for independent play. To enable all of this to happen, the law on which local policy is based, namely the Schools Safety and Supervision of Pupils Scotland, Regulations 1990, needs to be updated to include provision for formal supervision during the 20-minute period before school starts as well as at break times. Councils may be unreceptive to this, indeed one already citing lack of resources as a barrier. However, 5 of the 29 contacted have assessed the risk factors already and acted on these by implementing formal policy, managing mostly to do so within existing budgets. Other schools haven't because their local authority and ultimately legislation does not require them to do so. In summary, existing legislation recognises the safety risks at break and lunchtime within primary school playgrounds and requires appropriate supervision to be in place at these times. It is therefore reasonable, we believe, to suggest that a similar level of support be implemented nationally in the period before the school bell goes, especially for those children arriving via school transport. Local authorities are currently given too much freedom to define their own policy, thereby allowing schools to prevent inconsistent and often inadequate levels of care for pupils in their charge at this time of day. In terms of fulfilling their duty to provide reasonable care for children in loco parentis, many parents and carers throughout Scotland do not consider it adequate for schools to provide support from inside the building. We ask you to consider whether it would be deemed reasonably careful to leave a 4-year-old alone at a park, or standing alone outside a shop whilst you go inside to shop alongside a busy road, at risk of injury, bullying, abduction, or wandering off. In consideration of the evidence put before you today, we urge you to ensure that legislation recognises equal risk in the 20 minutes prior to the school bell, as it does at break and lunch times, and place a duty upon local authorities to make adequate provision for safety of pupils in their charge by providing formal playground supervision. In the words of a headmaster responding to the petition, pupil safety should be a top priority for all staff and schools. It's time it was made more of a slogan. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much for bringing a very interesting petition to us. The members have any views at the outset on this? John?
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you for the presentation. In your submission, you have referenced Glasgow City Council, who do not use teaching staff for that 20-minute period in the morning. They use janitorial staff. Now, you've made reference to teaching staff all the way through your verbal presentation. Would you be content if the Education Authority used janitorial staff rather than teaching staff for the supervision in the playground for that 20 minutes? Because I do see local authorities having concerns about additional teachers' time being used for that extra 20 minutes in the supervision.
From the evidence that's been presented to us through replies to Freedom of Information requests, it's clear that those counties that do currently make provision at that time of day are using a number of different resources: janitorial staff, support teachers, as well as teaching staff and head teachers. I would not have a problem at all if that were to be implemented by janitorial staff. And I believe that there is remit within a head teacher to actually provide training for those janitors so that they could deal with any eventualities in the playground. And that's what I believe Glasgow City Council have done.
Just that clarification, because as you said, many of the education authorities will claim it would be down to, and they have claimed,
yes,
it's
indeed
down to expense that they do not provide that service in the morning. But clearly, if
yes,
we can shift the debate slightly to say there should be supervision in the playground for that 20 minutes, how that supervision is delivered would be,
yes,
up to the local head teacher.
I think the key is the physical supervision,
yeah,
as you say.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I think it's also important to make sure that the staff are appropriately trained
yeah,
to take on that responsibility.
Okay. What's your definition of supervision? because we do have playgrounds that can be L-shaped, that can have, does it have to be visual at all occasions? I mean, given that schools vary in size, vary in their layout and geography, what do you actually mean by supervision? Does there have to be somebody there eyeballing, or is it wider?
Key is recognising that there really is very little difference between what exists now in relation to break and lunch times, where at least one member of staff must be physically in the playground at those times of day. And evidently the risks at those times of day are just as important, if not greater, in the period before school when traffic is far greater. So whatever is deemed acceptable currently at break and lunch times would be acceptable to us prior to school starting. Clearly, even in the situation at break and lunchtime where there are 90 children scattered hither and thither, one person on their own is going to find it very hard to monitor every single one of them. But of course it helps, it acts as a deterrent, and it hopefully prevents some incidents at least from occurring.
Okay. It does seem quite odd to me that, you know, when the bell rings, it becomes an imperative that something happens, but prior to that, it really is down to local decision making, the judgment of the school. In fact, what's needing to be asked here is why is that the case, and what does the Scottish Government intend to do to create that safe environment from the minute the child gets there until? But you know, when would that start then? Is a question I would add. I mean, some children might turn up at school 30 minutes early, but some might be even earlier than that, depending on when parents have got to get that child dropped off and then head off to whatever they've got to do. When would an appropriate period be? And how do you determine that?
Indeed. I mean, that's not for us to decide here today. However, at the moment, children are arriving at various times of day, depending on whether they walk, they take the bus, or they're driven. And I suppose it might be arguable to say that formal playground supervision were put in place from the moment that the school transport buses arrived. There is going to be variation from school to school as to when the bus physically pulls up in the playground. At the moment, we've been led to believe, and we don't know where this comes from, that some councils are fulfilling their duty by having a member of staff inside the building for 20 minutes prior. We don't know where that reference to 20 minutes comes from. We've not been able to find that, but it has nonetheless been quoted to me by councils in their responses. So it would be interesting to know where that comes from. Perhaps that could be identified by somebody.
Think as well, I mean, councils such as North Ayrshire have obviously done the risk assessment and deemed that the period that they suggest is appropriate. So there must have been some sort of risk assessment done when producing that policy. And it's maybe something that the Scottish Government could investigate as a guideline for all local authorities.
Well, that's a fair question, Kenny.
What level of training do you anticipate is necessary, given that we don't appear to have a consistent level of training for lollipop ladies or lollipop men? What level of training and what actions do you expect taken other than simply an adult presence?
Well, I think there's already a level of expectation at break and lunch times, and I think that level of expectation could be adopted in the time before school. I don't think that's unreasonable when the same risks are basically present, and as Lisa has said, perhaps more in the way of traffic congestion. So I think if we adopt whatever is regarded as the norm for break and lunch, then I think that's not unreasonable.
Presumably it would depend on who was providing the resource. If it was a member of staff, I've no doubt that issues concerning child safety are probably quite fundamental in their training as a teacher. Whereas if the solution were to utilise janitorial staff, that might necessarily not be the case, so they might then need extra training, but that would not be for us to decide perhaps here today.
Anzala. Yeah,
thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Actually, your petition's a very good one. I agree with you that there should be supervision in the morning as well. And I know of schools, as a prior councillor, that schools do take steps to have their playgrounds covered by members of staff either classroom assistants or others. So the training's already there. I don't think that's an issue. The issue really is about the resourcing in the morning, which currently doesn't happen. And I'm sure that given the challenge, the head teachers are very good people. I'm sure they could find ways of dealing with this issue. Chair, I'm very supportive of the petition. I think that I'm surprised that it's actually missing. I think that needs to be part and parcel of our schooling. We are living in very troubled times, and I think it's absolutely critical that our young are looked over before school starts, as well as lunch times and break times. So I'm very interested to see how the government is going to try and roll this out nationally. I think we do need a policy that so the authorities are, in fact, encouraged to make sure the appropriate cover's there.
I have a great deal of sympathy for what you're asking as well. It's just some of the detail needs to be clarified. But as you said, that's something that can be looked at and some analysis done. But it's certainly the principle of asking for that type of supervision prior to the school day starting seems to me to be very logical. The colleagues think we should ask various organisations to comment on this. And certainly the Scottish Government and COSLA must
definitely
be amongst them.
Has to be COSLA.
Yeah. The Health and Safety Executive in Scotland, the Royal Society for the Prevention of Accidents in Scotland, and the Association of Directors of Education in Scotland are suggestions that we have. John, do you have anything to add?
A couple of suggestions, Convener. EIS, given that they're talking about teaching staff, and also GMB, General Municipal Boilermakers Union, and Unison. Because those two unions cover the janitorial and the classroom assistant staff, auxiliary staff in schools. So it'd be useful just to get their views on it, because the additional responsibilities, as has been mentioned, that we may be placing on those staff may require appropriate training for those staff to be able to carry out the supervision to the level that would be expected.
And also potentially amendments to terms and conditions.
Yes.
So, yeah, there are aspects that have to be considered, but we can certainly ask for those things to be considered and see what the responses are. But thanks very much for bringing your petition to us this morning. We'll get back to you with the responses that we get, and we'll continue to look at the petition once you've had a chance to respond to the responses we get. Okay, but thanks very much for coming this morning. Thank you. I'll suspend again for a couple of minutes till we change over witnesses. Petition this morning is PE1585 by Isabel Lennox on behalf of Flag Up Scotland Jamaica on Scottish-Jamaican relations. Members have a note from the clerk, the petition itself, spice briefing and a presentation from the petitioner. So I welcome the petitioners this morning from Flag Up Scotland Jamaica to the meeting. They are Isabel Lennox, Graham Campbell and David Pott. I think, Mr. Pott, you're going to make some comments to us first and then we'll open it up to a discussion. Over to you.
Okay, so the three of us, just to introduce everybody, Isabel Lennox. I was born and bred in Scotland, which is one of the reasons why it's very important to have, with the Scotland Jamaica project, to have both Isabel and Graham Campbell, who is a Jamaican who has lived in Scotland for 14 years. So I'm the founder and the project leader of Flag Ups Scotland Jamaica. And I'd like to begin by quoting Sir Geoff Palmer, who's the Jamaican Professor Emeritus at Heriot Watt University. He's been a great encouragement to us, and indeed he paved the way for Flag Up Scotland Jamaica to begin. And in regard to this initiative, he has said this: the establishment of political, economic, cultural, educational and religious partnerships between the governments and institutions of Scotland and those of Jamaica would help both countries, which share a common history, to flourish as friends. And yesterday I also received from Anne McLaughlin, MP for Glasgow North East, this. She says, "I fully support the aims of this petition in the name of Flag Up Scotland Jamaica, on whose board I serve. It does not call for financial reparations, which it would be perfectly entitled to do. Instead, it sensibly calls for a change in focus in the relationship between our two countries. In 2014, I co-produced Emancipation Acts, a play that explored the involvement of Scotland in the slave trade and the legacy for both countries. From the audience's reactions, I discovered two things. First, that they, like me, had been largely unaware of the extent of our role in slavery. And secondly, and perhaps most pleasing, that they wanted to know and they wanted to put it right. The people of Scotland seem to be very open to acknowledging that slavery did indeed benefit Scotland and damage Jamaica. We are fortunate in Scotland that there appears to be little resentment from Jamaicans, and the bond between our countries remains strong. The cost to Scotland of doing as the petitioners ask is very little, but the value to us and to Jamaica would be immeasurable." So with regard to Flag Up Scotland Jamaica, we're still very much at a formative stage, but we have been very encouraged by what has taken place in the only 16 months since we started during the Commonwealth Games on August the 1st last year, with an opening which took place at the Glasgow Chamber of Commerce. And there does seem to be some momentum, which has been evidenced by sort of things continuing over the past year, schools partnerships and things like that, and our involvement in the Mela Festival earlier this year. But just this last week, I received a very encouraging report from our representative in Jamaica, Barry Warwick, and he's had a very good meeting with staff from the Ministry of Education in Jamaica, very keen indeed to set up schools partnerships. And also this last week, Billy Kay, the writer and broadcaster, has let me know that he is planning a documentary with BBC about Flag Up Scotland Jamaica for Black History Month in October this next year. So it's important, again, for us to emphasise that Scotland's ties with Jamaica are older and run deeper than those which are much better known, the links with Canada and New Zealand and Malawi. And so we believe that on grounds of consanguinity, like, of course, Graham is a Campbell, which is very typical, is one of the commonest surnames in Scotland. And it's thought that John Campbell, who was involved with the failed Darien experiment and decided not to come back to Scotland but stay in Jamaica, that he is the father of the many, many Campbells of Jamaica. And so even on grounds of sort of consanguinity and on grounds of the past economic benefit to Scotland, as well as the many and historical and cultural links, like, of course, the involvement of a Scotsman in the saltire being a key element in the Jamaican flag. So we think that we have very strong grounds for establishing a very creative and interesting and beneficial bilateral partnership between the two nations. And there have already been some pointers in this direction, such as the Memorandum of Understanding, which took place between JAMPRO, that's the Jamaica Promotions Corporation, and Glasgow City Council and Glasgow Chamber of Commerce in March of 2013. And there's a desire to make progress. However, in our view, in order for us to really make progress, we need the employment of at least one person in each nation, both in Scotland and Jamaica, to really start making things happen. So quite recently, we've had a very helpful and indeed inspiring meeting with David Hope Jones at the Scotland-Malawi Partnership. And what we came away from that was just a whole emphasis on positivity, There's not a lot about, you know, all the difficulties in Malawi, really. It's more this sense of equality and of sharing that, in fact, Malawi can contribute to Scotland and Scotland can contribute to Malawi. And so many Scottish people have benefited from the Scotland-Malawi partnership. And we perceive a great interest in Jamaica by all the Scottish people we've been talking about and this unusual partnership. A lot of people had no idea of the close links, all the Scottish names in the island, etc., that we believe that Scottish people could benefit hugely from engagement with Jamaica as well. So it's certainly not just like a one-way partnership. And so we believe that Flag Up Scotland Jamaica has the potential, with the support of the Scottish Government, alongside other partnerships, to deliver similar positive outcomes for both nations. And so that's what we're here for. We'd be very grateful if we could explore ways forward with you now.
Thanks very much for a very interesting introduction. I had become aware of the connections some time ago. I listened to, I think it was a Radio Scotland article on the issue, and it did strike a chord that we do have good relations with a number of nations, but I wasn't quite as familiar as I probably should have been with the cultural and historical links, particularly with Jamaica. So Your petition certainly chimes with the perspective that I gained, which was there were certainly good reasons why we should form stronger links with a nation that we already have historical links with. But I'm happy to open up to committee members to ask any questions. I think we should be asking questions as to how we can deepen and strengthen what's already you've obviously started to take forward. But if members have got any specific issues or questions that they want to raise. Angus?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'm not sure, as a MacDonald, whether I should be supporting a petition that claims there are more Campbells per square acre in Jamaica than in Scotland. It's just looking at the briefing that we have this morning, it details HMRC figures, which show that Scottish exports to Jamaica were around £1.5 million per annum over the past 5 years. So clearly there's scope and room for improvement there. Would it be your hope that if this petition were successful that we could increase international trade between the two countries?
I think that one's for me. Basically, Scotland's proportion is 1.5 million, but it's actually about a third of UK exports, if you like, abroad. Jamaica actually comes 52nd in the table of HMRC receipts from countries that we export to. That ranks it above Israel, Cyprus, Serbia, Bulgaria. So actually, Jamaica is actually quite an important export market for Britain. And Scotland makes up about a third of what Britain sends. So it's important, but it could massively be increased. Scotland has resources, particularly in areas where Jamaica really needs it, you know, construction, engineering, drilling, oil technology. There's a big plan to expand the Kingston Harbour into a regional super hub for the region between Latin America and North America. The Chinese are involved quite exponentially in development of the oil exploration and also in the expansion of the harbour. Scottish companies should and could be involved in that. But I think it's not seen as a priority area, region in the Caribbean, and that's wrong. I think it really could be a big place for expansion of Scottish and Jamaican businesses in both directions.
I think there's not a lack of interest in this. It's just I think there's a consensus, there's an agreement amongst members that you've certainly struck a chord and we should be pursuing this further. So we should certainly be asking the Scottish Government to give us their views on the petition and whether they want to try and take this issue forward. I can't remember off the top of my head. Do we still have a cross-party group on the Caribbean? Should we contact them if it still exists and we could ask them what ties they have that we could use. Certainly avenues that are worth pursuing, and I think you've made the argument quite strongly. So, Hansella.
Good morning.
Could I make a suggestion to see what councils in Scotland have links with Jamaica currently? There may be MOUs or twinning agreements that we're not aware of. Sometimes what happens is that councils do make agreements and then, unfortunately, sometimes with the lack of interest, they fall to one side. But if they're already there, that means you just need to reactivate those, and that becomes a good vehicle to move forward. It's something worth considering. We could maybe ask COSLA to make that on our behalf.
I'll redirect to each individual local authority. Yeah. Mr. Campbell?
Yeah, if I may respond to that one. I'm aware that Renfrewshire Council actually was one of the twin countries when we had Commonwealth teams being twinned with our local authorities. Renfrewshire got Jamaica, and I'm aware that they did do some work with them. So I think that may be well still be in play. So that's something we can certainly explore.
And see if there are hidden connections there that we haven't established yet.
Kind of new ones that. So last year I discovered that there was a person called James Johnson who was born in Huntley, and he went to Jamaica, and he was a doctor. He lived all his life then in a place called Brownsville in Jamaica. And he was also a very keen photographer. This is the 19th century, so a very early photographer. So some of the first photographs in Jamaica are by him. And he wrote the first tourist guide called The Jamaican Riviera. A wonderful, wonderful book. And he also rather unusually had this idea that Jamaicans would make much better missionaries to Africans. So he went with a bunch of Jamaicans and crossed the continent and wrote a book about that, his trip with Jamaicans across Africa. But, you know, an outstanding figure. And so I think that Huntley and Brownsville, I think, are fairly similar sized towns. And they both got secondary schools. And, you know, so that's the colour you just think is the natural fit here. You know, it's that kind of thing to try to make places aware of that. Bathgate is another very interesting one because a person called John Newlands, he owned plantations in what is now Western Kingston, and through the benefits and the finances from those plantations, he established Bathgate Academy and I think some almshouses and other things in Bathgate. And every year they have the Newlands Festival, and most people aren't aware that this patron of the town made his money out of the sugar plantations. And what we'd like to do is to try to get a Newlands from Jamaica over, because there are many Jamaicans with the surname Newlands. And, you know, it'd be fascinating to have a Jamaican Newlands there for this festival and see if we can get links between those two countries. And my colleague who's working in Kingston, he has found a school, a high school in the same area where Newlands had his plantation, and we're exploring possibilities of a link with Bathgate. So there are all these possibilities and, you know, exciting potential for creative and unusual partnerships. And we'd really like to see them develop, but we're very small. And so, you know, we're really looking for funding opportunities and to try to employ, as I say, I think at least two people in both nations who could give it, you know, plenty of focus. That's the kind of thing you need to get it starting to really work well.
Yeah. Angus, did you want to?
Yeah. Thanks, Convener. It was just to put on record that, you know, just on the back of that information that we're receiving, I found a briefing that we received in advance of the petition and the submission from the petitioners fascinating. I knew of the links with Jamaica, but to get some more detail was really helpful. So I'd like to thank the petitioners for enlightening me on the historical links between Scotland and Jamaica.
I think the country in whole benefit. I mean, I certainly know from my own local area close to Blantyre how beneficial it has been, the connection with Malawi, all the local schools in my area who've now got direct links with schools of similar sizes, or have made contact with organisations in Malawi and Blantyre there. Because of that historical connection. I just think it could be replicated given the information that you've brought to us, and I think it's a very worthwhile petition.
I live in Paisley, and as you know, Paisley is at the process of going through applying to be City of Culture 2020. Paisley became enormously wealthy through its fabric production that was used in Jamaica. It's a really exciting initiative, not just for supporting this across Scotland, but raising the profile as Paisley goes forward for this bid. So it's a really exciting thing, and we really recognise that things like the Malawi partnership, many, many Scots have benefited from that, and we would love to see that happen for the Jamaica project too.
Absolutely agree with you. So a lot of support around the table for it. We'll obviously write to the organisations that we mentioned, and we'll let you know what they tell us, and we can discuss it further at some point. Okay, but thanks very much for coming before us this morning to give your petition. Thank you. I'll suspend the meeting for a couple of minutes before we go to the next item. This morning is PE1588 by Daisy Harris on scanning all pets found on Scottish roads. Members have a note from the clerk, the petition and the spice briefing. And I'll also welcome Jackie Bailey, MSP, to the meeting, who has a constituency interest in the petition. But first we'll ask Daisy Harris to make some opening remarks, and then I'll give Jackie Bailey the opportunity to comment in addition to what you've got to say. But over to you, Ms. Harris.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting me to attend. Today, I will be talking about my petition to make microchip scanning of domestic animals recovered from Scottish roads compulsory. I will be covering why I feel this law is important to the public and how it would improve current practice. In April 2016, it will be compulsory to microchip dogs in Scotland. However, were a dog to go missing and be found dead, they would likely only be scanned for a microchip if the person who receives the body, highways worker, sanitation worker or police officer, is an animal lover. Many of these individuals do not even have access to the equipment necessary to carry out this procedure. A simple handheld scanner which can be purchased for as little as £40. On the Scottish Government website, it quotes MSP Richard Lockhead as saying, in 2014, over 10,000 dogs were reunited with their owners as a result of a microchip. This is an impressive figure, but it could be improved on dramatically by ensuring that all dogs are microchipped. What I and my supporters would like to ask is how the government plans to, as Mr. Lockhead said, dramatically improve numbers of reunited dogs if scanning is not a set policy but a best practice. I received word from a lady who had made an inquiry to West Lothian Council pertaining to the scanning of cats recovered from roads. They replied by saying they had one microchip scanner, which was usually kept in an office, and that most cats were not scanned and were instead put in landfill. Depending on who found the cats, some were stored in a depot for 7 days, but this seems random and unfair. I know from personal experience how horribly worrying and heart-rending the unexplained disappearance of a pet can be, and I know I speak for many people when I say that the few seconds it takes to scan an animal and the closure it could give to the pet's owners could mean the difference between moving on with your life or being left forever wandering. Owners of missing pets have been known to spend hours searching for their animals and hundreds of pounds on elaborate campaigns for their safe return. In November 2013, a pensioner searching for missing Border Collie Skye in Dumfries fell into a river and was hospitalised, and Skye's owners have camped out for weeks at a time in the hope of catching her and bringing her home. Yet they still don't know if Skye is still out there. If Skye had been killed on a road, her microchip is unlikely to have been scanned. On behalf of the hundreds of thousands of pet owners in Scotland today, I would like to ask for microchip scanning to be made compulsory. If pets are not scanned, they are not reunited.
Much, Ms. Harris. Jackie, do you want to add anything to the petition?
I think Daisy's covered it all, but you never find a politician that can resist an opportunity to say something. I met Daisy at a roving surgery in the town that she lives in. She'd already started a petition, clearly passionate and committed to the subject, and I suggested she bring the petition to this parliament. I suppose I should declare for the record I have a cat. She's called Smudge. If anything happened to her, I would feel devastated by it. And to not know strikes me as something that is even more difficult if you are that pet owner. It is inconsistent that we ask for pets to be microchipped, dogs in particular, but then actually don't use that microchip in a positive way to reunite all pets with their families. In England, scanning is compulsory. In Scotland, it's not. I don't believe that there is a difference in compassion north and south of the border. I think this is something that could be fixed quite easily. And as you've heard from Daisy, it's cheap and effective to do. So I would hope that the Public Petitions Committee very strongly encourage the Cabinet Secretary to do exactly as Daisy's petition requests. Thank you, Convener.
Colleagues have any comments to make? John?
Thank you, Convener. Just to ask Daisy a question. Now, we refer to the Scottish Government and the work that can be done. Your petition specifically talks about animals that are found dead or alive. Do you know what the current position is with the SSPCA or the Dogs Trust? Because I'm assuming that animals that are found alive will be either captured by local authority workers or the police and will be then transferred into the care of another organisation such as SSPCA and the Dogs Trust or some other similar animal welfare organisation. Do you know if those organisations carry out regular scanning of the animals that are put in their care by local authorities or the police?
I heard a recent case study just yesterday, actually, about a Yorkshire Terrier that was put in the care of the Dogs Trust and wasn't scanned. It was in their care for 7 years and wasn't scanned in that time. So I don't believe that they have that policy either. And after it was scanned, it was reunited with its owners. But that was 7 years after it was picked up.
Now, it's just to get that clarification because, as I said, particularly the animals that are found alive, and I think that's a very good example of 7 years later, somebody finally decides to scan the animal to find out there is a registered owner and the owner can be reunited with their pet. So, it means we can extend the number of organisations we can write to conveners to get clarification on what the current practice is in Scotland.
Well, I think that's a good idea, John. Yeah, we should get as much information as possible because I think there's a lot of merit in the petition that you brought forward. If it's doable in other parts of the island, then it should be possible to do it here. And I can see why, the benefits would be there in the way that you've explained the loss that people would feel unnecessarily just because they can't trace their pet. So I think there's strong merit in certainly investigating why it's not happening here. We can ask COSLA what the local authority position is, if they have guidance on this. But if Richard Lockhead has identified it as an issue, then we should certainly be asking the Scottish Government why they haven't taken it forward. There may be an explanation, but it would be interesting to know why they've identified the issue but not actually done anything with it. So it looks as though you've got agreement to take the petition forward in that way. So we'll get those responses and we'll send them back to you and we can look to see what the view of the organisations is and look forward to your comments on those responses before we take it forward after that. Okay, but thanks very much for bringing your petition this morning.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I'll suspend again for a couple of minutes.
is PE. What's my papers? PE1586 by James A. Mackey on behalf of Innes Community Council on statutory control measures for invasive non-native species. So members have had the briefing documents. Are there any comments on the petition? John?
Convener, can I declare this is an issue I've got a particular interest in? I have raised questions in the Parliament in the past regarding the enforcement in terms of the invasive non-native species issue, because while we have, and the petitioner quite rightly identifies, we have legislation there which I'm not sure if the legislation is being used against landowners to ensure that they actually carry out their duties under the legislation. I do know that in my dealings with Network Rail, which I've had several dealings with Network Rail regarding particularly Japanese knotweed and the constituents in the region, Network Rail have been quite good to act. But the difficulty is where we have other private landowners who fail to act, or developers who decide to go into areas where there is Japanese knotweed and do not take the appropriate action. And I note from some of the examples in terms of the spice briefing in relation to costs, it might be that some landowners, when they're going to develop the site, realise that it's more expensive to actually clean up the site than it would be to actually develop on it, and in some cases just go ahead and develop without doing the appropriate environmental cleanup, including eradicating the Japanese knotweed on the sites. So I'd be quite keen to write to the Scottish Government to ask their views on this, particularly the number of questions. I would like to also suggest we write to SNH, SEPA, because I think in one incident where I knew that a developer was trying to remove Japanese knotweed from a site, or they had not applied for the appropriate environmental licences to remove the site, there was no guarantee that the materials were being removed to a supervised and authorised site for that material to be dumped. So it would be useful to write to those organisations, because we now did eventually contact SEPA regarding the issue. They then referred me to SNH, and when I contacted them, they referred me to the Environmental Services, and the Environmental Services then sent me to the police, because they said it's the police that should be enforcing this. So there clearly seems to be an issue about who has the duty to enforce the actions that are there in legislation. I could also suggest that we write to RSPB and SWT, because I know they are two organisations, and I recently visited Barnes Hawk in Motherwell, where they do carry out clean-up of Japanese knotweed, and the staff are trained to deal with that. So it would be useful to find out how they deal with it. But I would also like to ask the Scottish Government, how many landowners have been prosecuted or have been reported under the current Wildlife and Countryside Act 1981 for the failure to treat Japanese or any other invasive non-native species, and what the level of the prosecution fines have been. My suspicion is there won't be many and the fines will be very low, but I think it's up to us all to make sure that we actually get the message out there that it is up to landowners to deal with this issue, and also local authorities. But it's just to reinforce that message that the issue, particularly of Japanese knotweed and giant hogweed, can be very dangerous and very costly, because I know that Japanese knotweed can actually come up through cement, and there have been some sites, housing sites, where it has been reported that Japanese knotweed is now coming up through people's houses. So it's really just one of these areas where we need to be trying to ensure we've got the legislation in place. Let's find out how the government is ensuring that legislation has been applied to landowners throughout Scotland, to try and ensure we get not only the curtail the spread of these non-native species, but also deal with them and eradicate where possible.
Okay, John, that's an extensive list of suggestions, which I'm pretty sure will help to investigate the petition quite fully. So the members agree that we do that? Okay. Our next petition is PE1587 by Arthur McFarlane on the Scottish Civic Forum. Again, members have a note by the clerk and the petition and a SPIFE briefing. Members have views on the petition? Kenny?
The government, I have to say, I think I can probably anticipate the reply, but I think we should at least...
Absolutely. Yeah, we'll do that. In the terms that the petitioners asked, we should ask the government to comment. Members agreed? Yeah, John.
Sorry for this. Could I suggest we also write to SCVO as well? Because while it's not the Civic Forum, it does bring together a number of civic organisations and voluntary sector organisations. So it might be useful to ask SCVO what their view on this is. And I know that the Civic Forum was a concept that was developed in 1998 to try and mirror what was happening within the Scottish Parliament. But given the growth of the voluntary sector and civic society is much wider than the Civic Forum, it'd be useful to get their views on the petition itself.
Yep, I'm happy to do that. I think members have agreed with that as well. Okay. And our final petition this morning is PE1590 by Nick Powell on behalf of the British Acupuncture Council on licences for acupuncturists. Again, members have a note from the clerk, the petition, a SPIFE briefing and a submission from the petitioner. Members have any views on recommendations?
Surprised that they were classified. It's the same. I mean, having had acupuncture, but that was more through physiotherapy. It does seem to me it's surprising. That's why I would welcome writing to both the government and COSLA to try and get to the bottom of it. They don't appear to me to be, they're not exactly apples and pears, but they're distinct services.
So as well. But yeah, interested to see what the government and COSLA's take is on it. Members agreed?
Yep.
Okay. So that completes our consideration of petitions this morning. We've agreed to take our next item in private, so I'll close the meeting to the public.